Today we're taking a look at a $99 macro ring flash from K&F. So let's get into it. Hey, what's up? I'm Scott and welcome to the channel. We do all kinds of test reviews, tutorials, anything photo and video related. So if you like the content today, please do consider subscribing and make sure to hit that little bell icon to get notifications when new content is uploaded. So what we've got here is the KF-150, a macro ring flash from K&F Concept, which is priced pretty similar to other budget ring flashes that I could find, but obviously much cheaper than the name brands. And as a little disclaimer, this is actually the first macro ring flash that I've used, but obviously I've used plenty of other speed lights, strobes, and so on, so I'll review it just as I normally would. The bottom line here is that while it's very simple, it comes with plenty of accessories, and it has pretty much all of the features that I think most people would want in a ring flash. The light is consistent, the recycle time is decent, and the build quality is no worse than you would expect for the price. I haven't seen any major reason at all not to recommend this if you are considering it, but of course, let's take a deeper look. So the KF-150 comes in this little soft case here, which is actually pretty nice, and it has these divided areas for the lens adapters, for the flash body and the flash head, as well as even a little flash foot that I really can't imagine using with a flash of this design. Inside, you get 6 of these adapters for lenses with filter threads from 52mm to 77mm, which just screw into your lens like a filter, and you can see I've already opened up a couple of them here. The flash body is pretty much what you would get with any regular speedlight style flash, and there's a coiled cable with a surprisingly heavy duty feel to it that connects the ring flash head with the ring flash body. I found with a Canon camera and the 100mm Canon macro lens, this coiled cable was just long enough, and while it was a little bit of a stretch, honestly if it was any longer it would just be too much. There are 2 little buttons on the side of the flash head here, which let you clamp it onto the lens adapter ring, and it holds on pretty tight. It doesn't spin too freely, which is good because there is a left and a right side to this flash, and you don't want to get those misaligned unless that's on purpose. Now, it seems like this wired part here is meant to be on top, even though the text is then upside down. So just keep that in mind. Besides the left and the right flash tube, this flash head also has some small LED modeling lights built in, which is nice for getting your focus in darker areas, which does often happen with macro photography. You can set it to be always on or only when you're doing it with focus assist. And you can also turn them totally off, of course, but we'll see more about that in just a minute. They're not all that bright and they do have a low CRI though, so if you're considering using them for video, I don't think it would be that successful. So back to the body of the flash, you have very basic and simple controls in the back here, and the buttons actually don't feel too cheap, and we'll run through the actual controls in a second after we turn the power on. The battery door is one place that I've always felt like you can actually feel the difference between a cheap flash and a more expensive one, and it's the same story here. It's nothing terrible, but you can feel the difference. Anyway, when you slide it open like this, you have 4 AA batteries in there, which is the same as most flashes. And you should get about 100 full power flashes from one set of batteries and 1500 at a lower power. From my testing, it seems like you might actually get more in practice than that, but those are the numbers from the spec sheet. To turn on the flash, you just hold down the power button for a few seconds, and this is generally what the layout's going to look like. There are 3 modes. You've got your manual mode, multi-mode, and TTL. Now, I honestly never use the multi-mode, but it works just like almost any other flash's multi-mode as far as I can tell. You're going to divide the flash times by the shutter speed in seconds to get the hertz setting. So 5 flashes in 5 seconds would be 1 hertz, 5 flashes in 5 seconds would be 1 hertz. You can set up to 8 flashes in here in this mode, and then that number of flashes will happen within the time that you've set for your shutter speed, basically giving you what looks like a multiple exposure in one shot with multiple subjects as they're moving in your frame. I found it a little bit tricky to use in macro mode, but again, if you want the feature, it's here and it does work. Now, TTL hasn't really been working all that great for me. Maybe with a different camera, it could have better results, but I wasn't having any luck with the EOS R. Maybe I'm missing something, but anyway, in TTL, let's take a look at how it works. The most important button here is probably going to be the ratio button, and that's going to allow you to either turn both flash heads off or turn on only A, which you can see by the icon on the side of it, is the left side of the flash, or turn on only B, which is the right side of the flash, or turn on both of them. And when you turn on, both of them, you then can see your ratio settings here, which right now is set 8:1, A to B. You can see that very clearly. So A is going to be 8 times more powerful than B. So if you click the center button here, you can then see it's blinking. That means you're selected for that setting. You're adjusting that setting. And pushing left and right will adjust that ratio. You can go all the way from 1:8 or 8:1, as you can see right there. When that's not blinking, so it's not selected, pushing left and right will adjust your exposure value. So this is like exposure compensation, basically. Remember, you're in TTL mode right now. Pushing up and down will then adjust your exposure bracketing. So this will allow you to take 3 shots at different exposures, like a bracket, basically one lower, one higher. And you can adjust both that and the exposure compensation up here in 1/3 stops. Taking a quick look at these other buttons across the top here, the first button will allow you to turn your modeling lights either off for only autofocus assist or back on continuously, which I have that right now. The second button here will turn your sounds off and on. So if it's on, you can hear the noise to let you know it's ready to flash again. The third button will then turn on and off your second curtain sync. Over here, the power button will also double as your backlight button. So pushing that will turn the backlight on or off, which is nice. And then pushing it once more goes into manual mode, which is the mode that I personally been mainly using with this flash. So let's take a quick look at how that works as well. For the most part, it's pretty much the same. These buttons across the top are going to do the same thing. The ratio button is going to turn on either just one or both of the lamps. And then when you push the center button, it will select things that you can then adjust. So you can push it again, it will jump down to that second setting here. Now, when you have something selected, pushing right and left will adjust this power in full stops. Pushing up and down will then go in 1/3 stops. So you can have a fine adjustment or you can have a faster adjustment. And that's pretty much all there is in manual mode. It's very straightforward. So as for a couple of practical examples of the power that this light puts out, at the lowest power and 1:1 macro distance for the Canon 100mm macro lens, I can get an exposure of 1/200th of a second, ISO 100 and F4. When you bump it up to the highest power the flash can put out with everything else remaining the same, I get F32. As for recycle times, at the lowest power, the recycle time is nearly instant. And as you step up the power, it starts to take about a half a second to recycle at around 1/8 power if you pop off a few flashes back to back. And then it takes about 1 second at 1/4 power and 2 seconds at 1/2 power. At full power, they claim a 2.9 second recycle time, and that seems to be accurate as far as I can tell. Could be better, but again, it's not bad at all for the price and the power. Now, there's no menu for deeper dives into things like backlight, auto off time, auto power off, or standby mode settings, or so on, which you do see with a lot of other flashes. But for the most part, I think that's okay. It's a simple flash, but it's appropriate for the price tag, and all of the necessary settings are quickly accessible. If they tried to jam too much into here for the same price, then maybe something else would have to be sacrificed, and I'd rather it be simple but reliable, which it does seem to be. As a quick note, I could also push this pretty far before it overheated, and even then, just waiting a few seconds and then cycling the power, turning it off and turning it back on again, I could get off some more flashes again. But when you step that back from full power, I could really get quite a lot of flashes with no problems of overheating. Most of it comes when you have this at full power and you're firing off a pretty decent amount of full power flashes back to back. Now, this can also be fun to use for trendy ring light portraits as well. But again, if you're looking to save money on something like this, I find it hard to complain and I would recommend it. If you need something more, then that's obviously your choice, but for under $100, I think this is a very good value. Now let me know if you have any questions or comments about things that I didn't cover here down below, and I will do my best to get back to you. But if you like this or found it helpful, please do consider giving it a thumbs up and subscribe if you haven't already. As always, thank you for watching.